Good afternoon, everybody. So, well, is I will talk about models and predictions, basic ingredients, dimensionless numbers, prediction versus predictability, and what can go wrong. The last five words of the title are not from Gabi, they are from myself. And the history of this title is a bit strange. Gabi sent it to me, I should talk about it. And for some time I thought, well, what the heck is he thinking I should talk about? And I sent him an email and said, well, you sent me once, you had given a lecture on models and predictions, which is true, but it was not on the theory of models, it was on climate models. But then I thought, well, I can try. And then I was looking a bit into the literature, and then I decided, because I'm not a specialist of the philosophy of science, I couldn't do it from scratch. So I thought I better talk about my personal experience with models and what can go wrong. Yeah. So I thought avanti dilettanti, and now you can see it. And here you see something monumental. What went wrong about 5 years ago, there was a big ship, the Costa something, and it was cruising through Italian waters, and the captain, an Italian guy called Schettino, he wanted to show his girlfriend how beautiful the island of Giglio, which is south of Elba on the Tuscan coast of Tuscany, is. And somehow they collided with the island, and a dozen people died. And a lot went wrong, because you can see the saving boats, they collapsed. So, well, good. Disaster. So what I will tell you, first some introductions. It's about approaches, conventions, mentality, purpose of models, then about basic ingredients, predictability, and then verification of models. And then you can see here starts the account of what can go wrong. Then about competing models and how to find out which model might be right or not right or good extrapolation. And then a few examples from weather and climate dynamics. Yeah, that's it. So, yeah. I'm happy that I can talk here at the University of Karlsruhe, because I was born at Karlsruhe, or to be more exact, in one of the hospitals of the town. Because originally I'm from Zeisenhausen, which is 40 kilometers to the east. A very nice landscape, very warm, very much of fruits and grapes and so. My parents have been living there. I grew there up. I just was born here. And I had some relations and a friend in Karlsruhe when I went to school. I went to school in Bretten, which is a smaller town. Melanchthon was born there. Somebody knows him. And well, I wanted to visit this friend, and she told me she was living somewhere in this area, yeah, Waldstadt. And she told me, come by train, there is somewhere here, the main station, take the red bus line, and ask the driver, he will send you off at the right bus stop, if you tell him the name of the street. I didn't have this map, so when I entered the bus, I asked the driver, where do I have to get off at this bus stop? And he said, get off at the penultimate bus stop. And then when I started to look somewhat incredulously at him, he said, well, sit down, I will tell you, because I didn't have a map. Yeah. So from his point of view, the information he gave him was very precise. But from my point of view, I didn't have a model in the sense of a map, so it was worthless for me. So yeah, I was just a passenger and waiting to be dropped off, but I had no picture in my mind where I should be, where should it go. Yeah, and that's has to do something with models. Yeah. So yeah, there's something of the motivation. And then you see, on the very left picture, you see a young man, and his parents have still hope he might become an engineer with Daimler or Bosch or something successful. And the second picture shows the same person 16 years later when he finished his PhD in theoretical physics. So but in my opinion, he looks more human than the first one. The next picture is 6 years later when he started to study geology and paleontology, and that is now more or less the state he arrived now. Good. And why do I put this here? Not because of my face, because I have lots of experience in different fields of science. Yeah? And this experience that there are different approaches and mentality in different fields was very, very good for me because, well, when I started to study geology for the first year, I thought these people were all crazy. They confused everything. In physics, you're taught to separate very carefully what are the assumptions you set in the beginning, what are the conclusions, and you're trained to see if you if you change something with the assumptions, what effect does it have with the conclusion, things like that. Yeah? And in geology and paleontology, I had the experience or the impression that they were confusing everything. And it lasted at least 1 year until I understood that it's dictated by the very nature of the subjects. Yeah? If you go through the landscape and do some mapping, you don't know from the beginning what to assume. It's a mixture of everything, and it takes some time to get a clearer picture, and you need a lot of intuition, which you have to develop, go around with a hammer, and after some time, you make the experience. During the first 3 days in field work, you don't know what sort of rocks are lying around, but after a few days, when you have made the first few discoveries, you have a good feeling, oh, in this area I might find the same rocks as have been over there and in the other side of the valley or something like that. And it really works, yeah? And you can't say afterwards why it works, you just have to think into the landscape, yeah? This was a very new experience for me. I had it in physics because you have to think into equations as well, but it was in a different level and, yeah. And so the conclusion was, after some time, one could say, in physics, you are boring a single deep hole into limited and well-defined area of firm ground. Huh? But in paleontology, you are boring many holes of unknown depth in a confusing landscape, which is located on shaky undergrounds. So that was my experience. And biology, it is somewhere in between. Huh? And yeah, and good. What did I want to? Good, yeah. That's and so this is the experience from I learned to use models in very different circumstances, and yeah. So in models which are in physics are thought to be well-defined and serious and convincing. If you do it in geology or paleontology, everybody will say, hey, what do you think? What do you want? And it's also the other way around. If in biology you make a model which describes plant physiology, if you have an error margin of 10-20%, everybody is happy. If you do the same in physics, they will tell you, well, go home and do improve it, then come back or so. And yeah, it's something. Good. The purpose of models, I did some thinking. I think something like the traditional purpose is a reduction of complexity. You develop some intuition. So usually you see a problem like Newton under his tree with the apple. And if he ever did like that, I don't know. But then the first step would be you translate the problem in the science of science into mathematical language. You do some abstraction process. You see an apple is falling, and it could be sent down from the tree. It could be attracted by the earth. It could be anything. And then you try to abstract somehow what might be the essential things which drives this apple also within the framework you know or used to. And this process of abstraction is some sort of formalization, mathematization, and this allows you, if you succeed in quantitative predictions or in paleontology of reconstructions, which you can compare with reality. So, that's one point. So if it fits with reality, you are content, you are lucky, you are happy. And but the second point is this abstraction process, it enables you to see some things clearer, because you get the idea, well, if you have something like gravitation and the apple is attracted by the Earth, you can perhaps get the idea that the Earth attracts not only apples, but also the Moon, yeah? Which on the outset might look quite different. Why should it be the same force? Apples are, you can see them a day, the Moon at night. The apple is falling down to the Earth. The Moon never crashes with the Earth. And so it's not so simple to get the idea that it might be the same mechanism, the same force behind it. Yeah? And my impression is, or my experience, that this process of abstraction in thinking into it in a different way, which is more sophisticated than everyday thinking, allows you to see similar things which you wouldn't otherwise not perceive. Yeah? So that's my experience. And then the third step is usually in the traditional procedure, you feed the results back into science and you extend your horizon. So because now you have a theory of gravitation, and then you can understand that it's just a thing of of the boundary conditions that the apple crashes with the Earth and the Moon does not. It's not something principle different. Yeah, that's something and which extends your horizon. You know something better. Yeah, good. And there's a present trend of the utilization of scientific results. The first steps are the same, but the third point is often that feedback is omitted. And here we are a bit at the discussion we had before in the panel discussion. There were the people asking, if you have our numerical or big models, how can we use the results from these analytical constructions, which were level upwards on the high abstraction level which Gabi presented, how can we connect it? How can we feed it into it? Yeah, and the problem is very often if it takes time for that feedback and to find the right point or the right stage where to feed back these theoretical results into things you can which are useful. Yeah, and my I have the impression that during the last 20 years, this feedback is a bit deteriorating, especially if you work in fields which are close to industry or things like that, which I do to earn some money. And yeah, therefore, boost the economy. Yeah. But if you want to understand something, you need to develop your intuition. And that is done by playing around with these abstract models. And when we are preparing the panel discussion, the students complained that what you were doing, and they said, I can imagine is how I know you, is that you try to play with mathematics. And so lots of the combinations you made come about from playing around with the mathematics. You have an equation, and then you think, well, if I add here something or change the exponent or make something more specialized or more generalization, how will it influence the result? And can I then draw different conclusions, other conclusions, or things like that? Yeah? And that is something, it may sound like some luxury, but it is necessary if you want to go on, because often in science you have, you're always thinking in pictures. Yeah, nobody can think abstract. It's cool. I was told I had to learn Latin language for 7 years because it was good for thinking abstract. I never understood what thinking abstract was. It is, everybody thinks in pictures, and the problem is if you have parts of science where pictures are not yet ready, or you have to find them first. So you have to try to get into it and approach the subject from different sides and to get a more coherent picture and feeling and then you can try to formulate mathematics only if you some preliminary picture of it. But you understand it. I hope everybody else too. Good. Yeah, so the basic ingredients of models, now we have the purpose of ingredients. There are certainly much better definitions. This is again from my experience. At least in natural sciences, a model consists of quantities which can be distinguished in some way and relations between them. So in other words, you have a structure. Yeah. And the predictability, it arises from the interaction of the structure, of the quantities within the structure. If you know the relations between them, the quantities, and a sufficient number of these quantities, you have a chance to determine the unknown quantities from them. And if you know the other quantities, you can go the other way around. So we have a structure which connects everything. And if you have enough information to put into this structure, you can calculate the parts which are still unknown. So that is the rough idea. And in more technical terms, in physics or biology, geology, the ingredients are variables and the equations connecting them. Yeah? And so within the framework of physics, in physics you have the idea that in principle everything which exists has to obey the laws of physics. Yeah? Biology, it's a bit different. You actually stick to living beings, living structures. Geology, it is still more not yet clear, but physics, well, if you're a true believer, everything must obey physics. And so if you build a model, it means you take those laws of physics which are relevant for the model, for the quantities and the relations between them, and you combine them in some way, or you specialize them, or you, yeah. But in principle, everything should be derivable from the basic laws of physics, yeah. And then the model means combining them in a skillful way. And here we see also some differences. You were talking yesterday of some models, how a population dynamics, they are of a different quality because they cannot derive from the physics of human beings or so, how they behave. It's impossible. In principle, it should be possible, but nobody can do it. They are just looking, you have some data, how many people lived at what time and how evolved it. And then you have a model which produces some a curve which looks similar, and you have some open parameters and try to fix them from the measurements. This is something completely different, yeah, and from this one. Also, you should clearly discriminate between. There are models which just describe something on a more heuristic level, yeah, because it seems to be something similar, and then you can try to make it more accurate and so. But you can never be sure that. Nothing happens which will disturb it in a serious way. But if you derive it from physics, you can at least in principle be sure you are on the safe side, if you believe in physics. Yeah, is that clear? Good. So, yeah, and then now we come to the ugly part, to the predictability and determinism. So a precondition for predictability is that you have this theoretical framework that allows you to express the sort for quantity you want to calculate in terms of other which are already known and the structures. Yeah? And this at first this sounds to be a simple, straightforward concept, but it often fails, and it can fail at different levels. Yeah? So there may be principal problems like in quantum mechanics. This comes with inherent restrictions with respect to predictability. You can't calculate the location and the momentum of a particle at the same time at great accuracy. The good thing is with quantum mechanics that it gives you also some equation which allows you to predict the inaccuracy which occurs. But the principle behind is very simple. It is if you observe something, you have to do some exchange with it, be it human people or a ball you kick or measure something, and you always have to have some interaction with the system you want to do the measurement, otherwise it's impossible and you disturb the system. And in classical physics or science, you try to make the disturbance as small as possible, but it's not always possible. I will bring some examples later on. Well, these are the principal problems where predictability is possible, but not at any level you choose. Then there may be systematic problems, I call it. These are the nonlinear effects. If you have nonlinear differential equations, very often you have the problem that they are very sensitive to initial values. If they change just a small bit, you get something completely different, some completely different results. Yeah? And that's, for example, I will show you in a minute about weather and climate. That can really be a nuisance. And then there are also many practical problems. For example, everybody knows it, incompleteness of data, lack of accuracy of initial and boundary values. People are doing field work, they know this much better than I do, because if you have a row of poplar trees and you should know for the theory the water potential everywhere in the ground, but you have only 10 points where you can measure it, so it's always a problem how to get any averaging which is making sense, which is reasonable. Yeah? Good, yeah, now to these nonlinear effects. Just told you, it's the extreme sensitivity of solutions to changes in the initial data. And I know this story, the classical example is the Lorentz system. It was a Dutch meteorologist in the 1960s, I think. And he was trying to describe an arc convection, which is if you put a pot of water on a heater, then after some time some convection cells develop and so on. And he tried to describe them with his system of three equations. X, Y, Z are the variables. Sigma, R, and B are constants, which are somehow connected with bundled Rayleigh numbers, Rayleigh numbers, and so on. And you see it is here and here, it is nonlinear because variables are multiplied on the right-hand side. And anecdotes go like this. He had first one numerical experiment. He had the green curve with initial values 8, 1, 1. And then he produced after some time, for it's one of these, the x-axis is x, y, or z, I don't know why, which one, it doesn't matter, but time goes in this direction. And so this green curve was produced, and then he started before going to lunch with a slightly different initial values, and when he came back from lunch, he had the blue curve, which starts also here, but here it's exactly the same as the green curve. But after some time, it diverged, and later on, it became something completely different. And this is the problem what they have with the weather. This was last Saturday. I was looking at wetteronline.de, and then they have provided some maps. These lines are lines of constant pressure, air pressure. And the different colors of the lines, they belong to different, slightly different weather models. were the same weather models, but started with slightly different initial values. The problem is the initial values for the weather models, you need something like the temperature of sea surface and land surface and pressures and so on. And you have you don't have it everywhere. You have just some points where it is measured. So they may be differing. But how the weather people, they try to circle around this problem by starting calculating 6 or 8 different model runs for 1 week and starting with a bit different initial values or slightly different models. And these 8 maps, they show the weather forecast one day after another. So almost 24 hours between them. And it's from the upper left to the lower right. And you can see the first 3 days, it's not so bad. Here in Eastern Europe, it becomes a bit problem of Ukraine. And then the fourth day also around the British Isles and Scandinavia. And then here, it's the sixth day, it's not so very nice. And the seventh, eighth day, you shouldn't plan hiking on the Zugspitze around these mountains based on these maps, yeah, because you don't know what will happen. So, and the bad news is this can't be improved in principle. It will always be like that. If the equations one thinks the weather obeys are correct, because they are nonlinear, and you can't escape from this problem. You can perhaps improve it for 1 or 2 days longer by having more accurate input data, but not in principle. It will not be possible. And it is interesting, historically, until the 1980s, at least in Europe, the weather forecast, which had the highest chance to become true, is a simple assumption that tomorrow will the weather be exactly like today. Because in Central Europe, a typical weather lasts 5 days. So in 4 or 5 days, it will be the next day will be the same weather. So we had a chance of 80% that it was true. And the professional weather forecast until the 1980s was much worse. Yeah. So good. This is it. Yeah, then verification of models. There are models which cannot really be verified, although in principle it should be possible. One example we had yesterday, the water transport system of plants. It is very sensitive to disturbances, and very often, Nadine had also this experience, when you try to do some measurements, you disturb the system to such a high extent that it collapses into its stable state, and you don't know what you are measuring, if it's a real system you want to measure, or if it's just the artifacts you started. Yeah. And but sometimes you are lucky. For example, here for the cohesion tension theory, you need the idea that the water molecules form a chain hanging down. It means the water can sustain a certain stress. Yeah? If you tear the two ends of the molecules, they won't come apart. And so there was, for 100 years about, people tried to measure the tensile strength of water. And it was very funny, because every 10 years they came up with higher values of the tensile strength. There were some theoretical predictions that it was very high, and from the first measurements, people thought, well, it's nonsense, they have miscalculated something. But then every 10 years, they came with much more higher values. And after some time, it became clear this succession of experimental values, it described only the inadequacies of the experimental design, or they became better because the experimental apparatus became better. And in this case, you had anyway an upper limit, which you approach slowly. Yeah? So this is the good news. Sometimes you trigger a system breakdown, but it goes in the right direction because you have this upper limit and you can be sure, well, it must be higher than this last value I obtained experimentally. Yeah? Good. Then there may be something else, these so-called no analog communities, especially in paleontology, you have the problem if you have extended systems in biology, you can calculate something and try to go to the fields, to the poplar trees or the corn fields and do the measurements of eddy covariance or whatever you are interested in. But if you have to do with ecosystems which are gone since 10 million years or 50 or 150, it's not so easy. Yeah? So paleontologists sometimes they think, well, so we could look at similar systems. The island Chilio, so you saw in the beginning in October, I will go there with a group of students to do something called actropaleontology. We will be looking at the benthos communities because they are supposed in today's seas, they are in some aspects similar to some communities living 100 million years ago. But there are communities or climates without any analog today. For example, in the Eocene, it was quite warm and you had higher CO2. And you find tropical, subtropical plants and crocodile remains in the Arctic and Antarctic areas. Yeah? So they must have been there because the position of the continents did not, of these did not move so much. And now the problem is these were in several respects extreme climates because during the North and South Pole you have in principle just one day per year and one night. So you have either very long days or very long nights. And combined with tropical or subtropical climate, you can't find it anywhere now. Yeah. So they have the problem. It is impossible to check it with reality. Yeah. So this is also often a problem, at least in paleontology. Another problem, only problems. In this case, you couldn't check anything, but now it may be a bit different. You can have too many theories, which all try to describe the same things. Yeah. So, this was a situation in the field of general relativity, which is just theory of gravitation, so an extension of Newton's theory. And between 1916, when Einstein found his theory, and about the 1960s, there have several rivaling theories designed or have been involved. Here you have a not exhaustive list until 1979. And so up to 1960, it was not possible to decide which one was the correct one, because you could do experiments, but the sensitivity of the experimentarian's apparatus was not good enough. Yeah? So within the limits of experiments, any theory was good as the other one. And this changed after 1960s, and then during the next 20 years or so, all of these competing models, but one, could be excluded, because there survived only one which predicted reality exactly, or it was the best one. And it was the one with the simplest mathematical structure, Einstein theory. and therefore, three cheers for Occam's razor. Maybe you know Occam, maybe not. He was a guy living in the 30th century, I think in England, William of Occam. He was a Franciscan monk and a scholar. And he was thinking about theories, and he had also somehow, I don't know exactly the background, the problem, what do you do if you have alternative explanations for one phenomenon? And he reasoned the best way to find out which one was best suited, take the one which has the least number of assumptions. So in other words, the most simple one. Yeah. If they all predict the same thing, just take the simple one. And this became true here. So, another old principle, which is still valid. Yeah, good. But the background for this approach, for being able to single out which one is the best theory, the condition is that you have a common framework, that the theories have the same basis. Yeah? And in this case, it was no problem because they have the PPN formalism. It's a parameterized post-Newtonian formalism. So it's some sort of approximations which can done for all of these theories. So you have a common ground, a firm ground, and then you can calculate what they would predict for a given experiment and compare them. So it was, in a sense of approach, easy. But things are sometimes can become more complicated if you have theories, competing theories, which have not a common ground. And there's one example in CO2 reconstruction in a paleontological framework. And Woodward, he noticed 1987, the stomatal numbers of plant fossils, they are sensitive to CO2. And there was some hope that stomal density or index is a function of only CO2 and species. And so people tried to experiment and they found, well, if you had a high CO2, if it was going up, the stomal density was going down and so. And so in a very ad hoc way, in a heuristic way, this stomatal ratio was developed. It was just assuming that it goes in inverse proportions, stomal density and CO2. And but then these gas exchange models came, of which Garvey was talking in the morning, the optimization model, everything. And from them, you know, for example, they use Farquhar's model of photosynthesis, which depends on temperature, because photosynthesis is chemical reactions. Chemical reactions with every 10 degrees they double their velocity or so. And also diffusion constants depend on temperature and many things. And so it is clear you need additional input information, otherwise they can't work. Yeah? Which is in a paleontological context not so good because you have not very much information. You try to do something with which you have. And that's often the problem. The people say, well, let's take this simple method because we don't have something else, which is a very bad argument. And the problem now is here you see in the y-axis the age of some fossil leaves. Those are the points here. And in the x-axis, the reconstructed atmospheric CO2. And the black broken line, that's data from ice core. It's from the Alaoid, which is the last stages of the last ice ages, about 12,000 years ago. So I think this black line is close to reality because these methods from the ice core, they are well defined and good. And the three blue lines, they are three different models from this stomata approach. And this one with a square, this is a stomatal ratio method, and the other two one with dots and the triangles, they are gas exchange models. One is from Peter Frank, the other one, which is called Rom reduced order model, is from we were part of it, and you can see the results are quite different, yeah, and. The one which fits best, it's the raw model at the moment, but it does not fit exactly because the temperature has been an input, is everywhere the same, and it certainly wasn't everywhere the same because there are 500 years in between, and the temperature did certainly change. Yeah? And you never know exactly the individual leaf you found in the ground and can count the stomata if it has been a shadow or a sun leaf or something. So the problems we discussed on the panel, do I have sun leaves or shade leaves? Or you need to get lots of data, more and more data, until you can sure in paleontology, you're happy if you have three leaves. And and if you can date them and say, well, this is 200 years older than that one, because stratigraphy, it's a nightmare. The River Elbe, in one flooding, it left after one day a meter of sediment. If you go to the deep oceans, 1 meter of sediments is accumulated in 1 million of years. Yeah? So there's anything in between. And so someone comes and say, well, we can discriminate 100 years. It's, yeah. Anyway, that's paleontology. Good. Is there still more problems? Yeah? Good. There was a wrong direction. Another problem is the extrapolation of models. Talking about CO2 content of the atmosphere, to the left you see the carbon dioxide of the atmosphere through the Phanerozoic. So at the right end of the x-axis it's in the Cambrian, which is 550 million years ago, and then to the left it goes to present time. So this is reconstruction, and on the right picture you see the prediction for the next 100 years or so. And the problems with all this is that it is based on a small interval of reality of about 200 years or even less, during which you have reliable data on temperature and temperature of sea surface and whatever you need for these different models, at least for these which calculate into the future. And so it's a question if it is this reliable or not. And in that connection, there's something you talked in the morning about the Boyle-Berry and Leuning models, which are necessary to close the number of equations. And these models, they are also heuristic models. They are motivated by, they look plausible, but they have two open parameters. And these you have to fix for measurements of extent plans. Yeah? So the problem is, if you use them to calculate these curves on the left, you are using measurements of plants which exist now, and you at least implicitly assume that there are also valid for these species or for the ancestors which lived 50 million years ago or so. But plants adapt to the environment, and you never know exactly. 50 million years is a long time. Yeah? Human species is perhaps 2 million years old or something, and the typical lifetime of one species of ammonites on the Jurassic Mountains was 1 million years or something. Plants are a bit better, maybe perhaps 10 million years, but then becomes difficult. So this is one weak point of these models, of these heuristic models. If you extrapolate them very far, you can't be sure that it is correct. These models are very good if you calculate now for your poplar trees or something like that, because they are in the range which they are used to. I thought it is also one of the good things of the optimization theories, because they don't need these open parameters which are fitted to something, because they work on a mathematical higher level. And so the functions they derive, the missing function, it does not depend on any sort of parameters. They calculate the real function as such. Yeah? And so I think in this field, these optimization models are really better, because they don't depend on these local measured parameters or so. But well. So I think this is now, the overview. And then I have still a few more slides of as an example, because many of these problems you find also in the equations on climate models and weather. And I have still about nine slides, which I Good show. Shall I do it now or shall we have a break? Or? It's your choice. Shall I go on? Good. I told in the beginning you need some sort of quantities which you connect by some interactions. And here in this picture you are some of the interactions or the influences on the climate system or weather system, whatever you choose. You can see there are lakes, there are mountains, there are precipitations, solar input, there are human influences and so on. Everybody of you knows it, so I don't have to talk a lot about it. And the climate models, well, in principle, what climate means, the movement of air and water on the Earth's surface. Yeah? So, and the interactions between liquid water, water vapor, and so on. And the relevant equations, they come from hydro and thermodynamics. Yeah? So, and they can be written as a conservation of momentum, mass, and energy. This leads to the Navier-Stokes equations, and so on. And you know it. And if you have also some equations of state, for example, the density of seawater, you know it depends on pressure, temperature, and also trace elements of things, and similar in air. If you have some sort of laws of chemistry describing the carbonate system or what happens in the atmosphere with these climate gases, so on, you have a closed system. And if you can calculate these quantities, these basic quantities, for every point on the Earth's surface, in the atmosphere, in the sea, at every time, you know everything about the system which you can know. Yeah? So everything is fine. The problem is, these are the relevant equations. To write them down is not so hard. The problem is to solve them. And the main problem is in the second term on the left-hand side, on the uppermost equation, it's non-linear, Navier-Stokes equation. And it makes a lot of problems. If you have seen, everybody knows here. Yeah? So, and things are not so simple. But in principle, it would be very simple. You get the solution, you know, of any fluid, any component of the air, what it's doing now and the next second. So there's also, and of course, you need some initial boundary conditions. That's a problem in itself. I talked about it earlier. You don't have measurement stations everywhere on the Earth and on the upper fringe of the atmosphere, on the basement of the oceans. So you have some point of data, and the accuracy is not always very good. And you have to do some averaging over perhaps large areas and can't be sure what happens. Huh? So, and the general properties of the system of linear the thing is, if I said it before, if these equations could be solved, everybody would be known. The bad news is realistic situations, they allow no explicit analytic solutions. You need to do numeric things, and this goes back to what I was talking earlier. If you want to do a model, to get a model, and you have to poke around, you have to try to approach it from different directions, you have to play with it. And this is much easier with explicit analytic solutions. You can say assimilation rate is a function of CA, CI, photosynthetic parameters, diffusion constant, anything, and you have explicit formula for it, which you can solve for any other quantities. You can put it into the Navier equations, eliminate some variables and things like that. And this, if you can do only numerical solutions, it's much more difficult. You can't do it. Yeah? This playing around, which is, at least in my experience, a precondition for understanding in an intuitive sense, it's more or less impossible. Yeah. If one run of the whole system, somebody told yesterday he needs a supercomputer in Munich for some time, you can't play around with it. Well, to a limited amount, probably yes. But at some point, the system administrator will say, well, what are you doing? And if you have an enormous output of data, it's not too simple to get an idea what is going on. Yeah? And a few years ago, I was in a conference in Zurich. There were some foresters, and they were talking about they were making ecological models, what the forest in France will develop, what sort of trees will survive, it becomes more drought or more or less precipitation and so on. And there were a series of talks all on this subject, and about 3, 4, 5 people, they used different models, and they had completely different results. But when you ask them, can you explain why your results differ from this one, nobody could tell, yeah, because this step was missing. They have a very complicated computer code, and you can fill in something, and it will always produce something. But to get a feeling if it's reliable or not, it's very difficult, yeah? Especially if you have a system which will come true only after 50 years. If it is some experiment for which you have the outcome, it's easier to say, well, this is reliable or not, this code. But if you have to wait for 50 years, what are you doing? Yeah. Good, so that's about analytic solutions. And then the solutions, all of the weather system are sensitive with respect to initial conditions. I showed you already the weather maps for the next 8 days. And yeah. Good news is, if you want to talk about climate instead of weather, you can have some mean values which are more or less reliable. Good. And then what is also a problem with weather or climate prediction, the model zoo, it's been ever increasing. From left to right, it's a progress in terms of time. In the mid-70s, they had models, more models in atmosphere, sometimes only one or two dimensional models, land surface, ocean, sea, ice. And then these models become bigger, they added some dimensions, more accurate relations and so. And this FRR, these are the first assessment report of the IPCC, second, third, fourth and fifth assessment report. They come every few years, and the last one was, I think, 2 years ago. And you can see that more and more was metal. The initial parts of the model, they grew, and then there were added aerosols, which are important for climate prediction. If you have dust in down here or in the stratosphere, it makes much difference. If a volcano is breaking out, the carbon cycle is important. And the dynamic vegetation, for a long time, vegetation was simply neglected. And then for another long time, it was just assumed evaporation is some constant or something like that. But that plants are some dynamic part of the system. It took a long time until it was recognized. You were talking about it a bit, and then atmospheric chemistry. Well, these things become more complex, and it's still more difficult to get an overview. So in principle, one colleague in Tübingen said one day, well, meanwhile, the climate models are more complex than the weather itself. Yeah. Also with these climate models, you have the practical system with the equations. This is a repetition of some I told you before. The values of the initial boundary conditions, they are often difficult to obtain. They are on the sea, on mountains, somewhere. You need enormous amounts of data input for the initial boundary conditions if you want to make more or less accurate results. And the output is also lots of data. And well, still one of the problems with the weather forecast is you shouldn't have a model which takes longer for the forecast than the weather to arrive. So this is also some limiting thing, so the capacity of the computers they are using still. And another point is you break the models up in model up into submodels, and if you look at the soil, there are orders of magnitude of micrometers are important for the interaction between roots and soil and within the soil, the capillarity and things like that. But a low or a atmospheric high, it's about a diameter of 1,000 kilometers. So you have enormous range of 10 of 6 of relevant length scales. And the guy with a supercomputer, he knows what I'm talking about. It's very difficult to find a common footing just on this technical part of computing. And something more serious is that some submodels cannot be based on first principles of physics because they are not very good known. And so they are approximated by parametrizations which require calibration. This is the same problem I mentioned with ball bearing models. You can do these calibrations at some point, perhaps in the atmosphere here on sea level or land level, but you need it for some point in the stratosphere, and you can never be sure if the calibrations are reasonable, if they work up there. Yeah. Good. Well, partial layout, make manageable submodels, make spatial self-time with numeric solutions, but with everything I told you. So, something else. The boundary conditions may change with climate models in the sense of boundary conditions in a loose sense. It turned out that meanwhile, human beings, how they form the economy has a more important influence on the climate than natural disasters like volcano outbreaks or something. And so you have somehow to take it into account, yeah? And so these IPCC people, they try to define various economic scenarios, which are different. It's in German, excuse me, but it should be obvious what it is meant. And they calculate for this, at least for these four models, what happens. And unfortunately, they changed this scheme a bit, and now they talk of this RCP 856 and so, but they can more or less compare it. And if you use these different economic scenarios to calculate CO2 and methane concentration for the next 100 years, you can see that is the predictions are quite different. CO2, if we have an economy which works like the one we have at the moment, CO2 will go up to nearly Eocene values of nearly 1,000. And if you change economy, it could be around, well, a bit over 400, which we have now. And there are also alternatives in between. And more or less the same is valid for methane. Yeah? So this is also a problem. You don't know how economy will develop. If you depends on what sort of president you elect in the US or in China or here, how should you know? Good. So, I'm already at the end. So the summary, models, it's very short. Models are necessary to understand nature and to make prediction and instructions. And then an advice, be good to your models. Never apply them outside the range of applicability. Never stretch them beyond their limits. And then they will reward you with new insights and a happy life. And you don't have problems which turn up and you try to solve them and realize only after a long time the only problem was that you stretched them beyond their limits. Yeah. So, good. That's it, what I wanted to tell you.